was the prayer concern?
I'm looking.
Did one go around?
I'm looking for it.
No, I don't have it.
I don't think it went around.
You don't have it.
No, what you left about the prayer, I got one.
Fine.
He's looking for the prayer. John, honey's got it.
Hey, you got it either.
I actually, it's a bird I like though.
I thought we might have some of that all left before I got back. So that's, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Does anybody remember where we left off?
I have it written down here.
Okay.
Eleven.
Nick, because if you don't know, then I start over. How that is.
And he himself gave some to the apostles.
What was that?
And he himself gave some to the apostles, I believe they were out of turn.
Okay, verse 11, okay, all right.
I thought the introduction to Bible.
Okay, all right. Praise the Lord. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we come before you tonight, Lord, and we thank you for this day that you've made. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for you are our hope, our life, our strength, our salvation. You are the Lord and King of our life, Lord. We come tonight, Lord, to give you praise, give you glory and honor. Lord, right now, Lord, I pray that we would just bring every idle thought into captivity, Lord, that we would quiet ourselves, Lord, in your presence. Lord, that we would focus upon you, Lord, and begin to know, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that we have come to sit at your table. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would open up our understanding to your word. As you begin to explain to us, Lord, the order of the church, Lord, the organization, Lord, and that that you have put in place, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, that you're revealing, Lord, that you have gifted us all, Lord, to work, Lord, in the kingdom. And all are needed, all are important. Lord, I pray today, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that we would embrace you as you have embraced us, Lord, love you as you have loved us, Lord. And so that I pray tonight, Lord, that we would encourage, Lord. We're mindful, dear Heavenly Father, Lord. I hear coughing, Lord, and I know there's other things that may be going on in the midst of the congregation tonight, Lord, but you are in the mix, Lord. You are in the air tonight, Lord. You are here, your presence, Lord. It is truly felt, oh God, Lord, and we pray tonight, Lord, that we would draw from you. And so have your way. Have your way. And we'll give you all the praise, give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
As we were looking at the organization of the church, sometimes when we think about the church, we like to talk about the freedom of the spirit, how to be free in God and how to worship and all those things there. We sometimes talk about being free in the sense that you just go spontaneously running after the things of the Lord. But when you look at the Word of God, God lets us know that He is a God of order. In fact, Jesus explained it this way. Jesus said that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. And then he says, and the things that you hear me say are the things I hear my Father say. The things you see me do are the things you see my Father do. Then he says, and the Father and I are one. And then he tells us about the promise of the Holy Spirit. He says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will send you a comforter. But he will not come to boast of himself. He will come to speak of those things concerning me. Now here we have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And we find that there is an order in the Trinity, the order of God, that we know that Jesus said, I come that the Father's will be done. I come to serve the Father. I did not come to be served, but I come to serve the Father. So we know that God the Father is that Jesus said, I submitted myself under. And yet we know that if you see the Father, you've seen the Son. For Jesus said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And yet there's an order. And then he says the Holy Spirit does not come to do anything other than to reveal Jesus to us. The Holy Spirit, the life force of God that becomes real to us. And then when we look at Genesis, we begin to see the action of it. We begin to see the desire of Father. God Father desires to have, let there be. And he has this desire in his heart, and the Word of God was out. John says that the Word became flesh. So we know that in the Trinity, we had God the Father, God the Word, and then God the Holy Spirit. The Word went out, and then the Holy Spirit took the Word and began to make it happen. So we find the desire of Father, the desire and the parent's presence of the Word of God, and then the empowerment of God, the Holy Spirit. So when we're looking at this here, there is order then in the Godhead, that they're equal. The Godhead, there's only one God, but the operation of God is, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So it isn't that one's greater than the other, but the operation, there's an order of things in the Godhead. So if there's an order of things in the Godhead, then there ought to be an order then in God's church. There ought to be an order on how things are done. There ought to be an order then in our lives on how things are going to, how to operate. Have you ever met somebody that says, I'm just spontaneous? I don't really have a plan. Whatever hits me. In fact, some of you may be one of those Bible readers that do those things such as this. I say, where do you study at? Oh, I don't really study. I just open up the Word of God, and wherever He leads me and stuff, that's the Holy Spirit leading you. That's not how God operates. That is really not how God operates. He did not give us the books of the Bible and then say, close your eyes and just pick something. There's a reason that He gave them to us. Now, I'm not saying that you have to read it in all order, Genesis, Revelation, but I think that you ought to have an order in what you're reading. If you're reading something, you're looking at something, get into it and purpose your life to say, I'm going to begin to read. A person asked me recently, says, where do I start to read? I says, you read John. And then I used a word from Dale. Dale said, a man asked him, what do you need to read? Dale says, you read John. When he got done reading John, he asked Dale again, now what do I need to read? And Dale says, read John. When he got done reading John again, he came to Dale and he says, Dale, what would you have me to read now? And he says, read John. So what we find out, and that's what I said to that person, let's get John down inside of us that we might understand the God-man. And that's what John is about. John is about the God-man. So we ought to look at the Word of God with a purpose and an order in our life, because we serve a God of order. He is not a God of chaos, and He is not a God of chance. And God did not think after Adam and Eve sinned in the garden that He said, oh, now, Father, what do we do? But Jesus said before the foundations of the world, He was. He knew that He was coming to save man before they ever formed man out of the dust. So what I'm saying all of these things is that we begin to understand there's an order in God. And if there's an order in God, then there ought to be an order in us who are in Christ Jesus. Our life then should have a plan, a purpose that God would have us begin to live out and to do. We should begin to desire to live with Him and walk with Him in a way. So each and every one of us ought to have a planned life in Christ Jesus. Amen. An order of thing on what we're going to do. The Word of God tells us to study or to show ourselves approved, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, who is able to rightly divide the word of truth. The Word of God encourages that we aren't to study, that we ought to put it into action, that we ought to begin to allow God to reveal Himself to us, that we might experience Him. So we look at this organization of the church. We find then that it's not about the idea that God is saying that you got to dot every I and cross every T. That He's not even saying that if you do this, 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 and then this will be the perfect result of things. No, but He says there's a thing that we need to know, that if you seek Him, you'll find Him. If you ask, He'll give it to you. If you knock, the door will be open. So there's an order of things. So sometimes we're asking, it's about, well, I'm looking for this in my life, and I'd like to have this. Well, have you talked to God about it? Well, you know, He knows everything. Did you ask? Because He says you have not because you've asked not. So there's an order of things. If you want something from God, then you need to talk to Him. Now, we understand that because why? Many of you here tonight are parents. And you've said to your kids, I'm not a mind reader. Some of you wives have said to your husbands, I'm not a mind reader. Husbands have said to their wives, I'm not a mind reader. And what they're saying is that if you want me to know something, you got to talk to me. God says, I know what you want, but if you want it, you got to talk to me. He said to those that were needing a healing in their body, needed Jesus to do something to them, He asked them the question, what do you want? Do you think about that when Jesus was talking to the lame man that was laying by the pool of Bethesda, says to him, what do you want? He's a lame man, laying down on a cot, cannot walk, and Jesus says to the lame man, what do you want? And when you think about that, you say, Lord, why would you ask such a question that is obvious. The truth of it is, I've talked to many people that something was obvious to me, but guess what? They didn't know what they needed. They did not know what they needed. They knew that their life was in a place, but they didn't know that they needed a change. See, we can get comfortable laying on the cot. We can get comfortable in our mess. We can get comfortable in this place of defeat and then think that this is my goal. This is my call in life, to suffer in these things that I did. And Christ did all the suffering. What he's done is set, come that we might be set free. So we're looking at the text now. We're going to be talking about the organization and the local church. Down there at the bottom, that it just talks about that as officers. He gave to the church apostles. This refers to the 12. There were, and there are no apostles in the church today. When you read that statement, I told you that in the beginning when we started this almost 2 years ago when we started this study, in this New Testament study, that I don't agree with everything that he says, though it is a great study. The truth of it is, what he said was error. And how do you know there's an error? Paul writes and he says, I am apostle. Paul was not one of the 12. And he said there was no other apostles other than those 12. Now the other thing that he may be saying that I've heard others say was that they took and they drew the straw, and they said Matthias is the new apostle. He's the one that's replacing Judas. But we didn't hear anything about Matthias, but you'll read about Matthias when you talk about the books of Fox's Book of Martyrs, and you'll find that he is there. You'll find that he was active in the ministry of Jesus Christ. What it would also say then, that Jesus did not lead them into doing that, that the Holy Spirit was not guiding them to make that choice, because they knew within themselves that someone had to replace Judas. And who was going to replace Judas was somebody that had been with them from the beginning. So when Paul talks about himself, he says, I am apostle, but I have come in due season. I've come at a later time. I didn't come like the rest of them. So he's right that there was 12, but to say there's 12 and there's no more, then it would be error, because why? Paul himself says that he is an apostle of Jesus Christ. And so as we're looking at scripture, I'm just saying that everything that we read, and this is important, there may be some great studies out there, but we always have to line everything up according to the Word of God. And so the Word of God tells us that Matthias was one of the 12. After Judas, he was picked. And he was picked because of the leading of the Holy Spirit, guiding them and directing them in that manner. And then when he met Paul became an apostle. But you know what? Barnabas was an apostle. See, what I'm saying is that there was more to this than what he is saying here. He makes a statement, but scripture says he's an error. But he goes on to say that says that no apostle in the church today, prophets, we have no prophets and have not had since the last book of the New Testament was written. Again, what he is talking about is that with the prophetic word of God going out. But Paul tells us when they're talking in Corinthians, and he begins to describe the gifts of the Spirit, he tells us that one of the gifts are speaking prophetically. He says speaking in tongues, he talks about that gift. But when he's talking about that gift, he says, I speak in tongues more than any of you, but I would rather that you would speak prophetically, and he's talking about the Word of God, explaining to you, because I would rather give you words of understanding, that people may be embracing what God's Word has to say for their life. So then Paul instructs us and let us know, when you are speaking prophetically today, you are giving people the Word of God. It's a prophetic word. It's a word that lets us begin to understand God's plan for mankind. Plans for his church, plans for the believer. And the Word of God is a prophetic word. And when you're doing that word, you're not giving people your thoughts and ideas. What you're giving them, you're explaining to them the Word of God for their life. And it's a prophetic word. So when you say prophet, oh, there's nobody telling you something that is not true, in the sense, the fact that we can't create anything, because Psalmist said that there is nothing new under the sun. We have the Word of God. We begin to see some things that are happening, and we find that some things have been spoken we see that some things have been revealed to us that have been talked about what was going to come. And Dale was talking to me about a man who wrote a book, Derringer or something. There was a book that was written, and it talks about the prophetic things that were going to happen in the world to come. The book was written, and then we find all of these things begin to happen. We find that of even the Twin Towers and the fall of the economy, all of those things, and they went down the list. But the author of the book wrote it, and then he said, what a prophetic book this is. A word that is coming true of the day. But now what it says, the word didn't tell us about that there was going to be the twin towers falling, but what it tells us is that things are going to get worse. Turmoil, troubles, tribulations, our world is going to get worse. So if we find that, we can say then that the things that we're living in is according to the truth of God's word, it's going to get worse. But if you ever read that book, you'll find that the things he was stating were exactly the things that unfolded in the years to come after that. He had a prophetic word. So to say that there's no prophets today, it's not about the changing of the word, but God does give understanding. He does give visions. He continues to reveal things to us today. But it is not like that of the prophets of the Old Testament or the prophetic word that was given. We're not talking about changing the word. So when you're looking at that part of it, no, there is no prophet, for the word of God has been written. But I still believe that the gift ministry of Christ is still a prophetic word that's out there. Then he goes on to tell us that here it says that there, he says there's no, since the last book of the New Testament was written. But then he says evangelist. The evangelist will serve the church until Jesus comes. And he's talking about the evangelist. He's talking about the fivefold ministry of the evangelist. And that is that person who has an anointing of God, and we'll talk about that later. And what he does is share the word of God, and people come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And in our lifetime, there's been no greater evangelist than Billy Graham himself, where not only tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands have come, but I would even say that millions have come to know the Lord through the preaching of the word that Billy Graham has done in his lifetime. But then the word of God tells us to do the work of an evangelist. So then there's a work that also that you and I can do, and that is what? Sharing this hope that others might come to the saving knowledge of Christ Jesus. The anointing, the gifting, the call of it may not be as sharp as that of the evangelist, but we all have been instructed to be an evangelist and do the work, sharing this hope that is in us about the hope that is in Christ Jesus. Then it goes on to say to us, Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, it says that the evangelist will serve the church until Jesus comes. Pastors and teachers, Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, it goes, pastors and teachers are our local ministers, the apostles, prophets, evangelists, or ministers at large. What it's talking about then is that there are those in certain areas of authority, and then there's that's over the church, and then there's those that have operation within the church. So one is at large, is over the church, and the other is at large in the church, and that's what he's talking about in the difference. So when we look at this here in Ephesians 4, it talks about in 1 and 6, walk in the unity. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. He first begins us to read in Ephesians is that in Christ Jesus there is unity. There is a demonstration of us understanding that we are the body of Christ and we are to operate in unity. When your body does not operate in unity, you're trying to go one way and your body is going the other. We see people that have birth defects or effects of that struggle, and they're trying to make their body do something, but their mind is telling them to do something else, and they struggle, and you see the fight on how to coordinate, how to move, all of those things there. He says the body should not have schism in it. We should work accordingly and move smoothly as believers. So he says, therefore, that we should walk in unity. Therefore, the prisoners of the Lord, that we are captive in Christ Jesus. We belong to him. We are his servants, and so prisoners of the Lord, we have chosen to follow him, that we are bound to him. If I'm going to be in bondage, if I'm going to be tied up, let me be tied up for the things of the Lord and never the things of the world. Then he goes on and says, I beg you to walk worthy of the calling with which you are called. I think it's important that we understand it's not just about the fivefold ministry. We have all been called to be light in the midst of darkness and be salt in the midst of a sinful generation. That we have all been called to share this hope that lies within us. As he's saying, as children of God, we also walk worthy in the calling which we are called. You are saints of God. You are a royal priesthood in Christ Jesus. And because of that, should you not work and live a life worthy of your calling? There was a thing not too long ago when Queen Elizabeth there was something that was going on. It was a big deal over in England. And whatever it is, one of the grandsons wasn't paying attention. And the queen gave him one of those looks. Get up from what you're doing. Stand up and do what you're supposed to do. You're royalty, and you are expected to act like royalty. And she didn't say a word. With the look, he understood. He stood up and took his place and position because there was something going on out there that they were supposed to be responding to. And that's what he is saying, that we need to be called according to, walk worthy to the calling that is in us. If we're children of God, then we need to live like, act like, and behave like children of God. And as they used to say in the prison, if you can't say amen, you just say ouch. You know, because that's the call. That is the call that he's saying to us. And then he says, and we do it how? With lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love. He's saying, as the body of Christ, we need to know, as the church, we need to bear with others because why? We are a family in Christ Jesus, and all of us have a family. And if your family is like my family, you need love. Huh? Because why? We don't always see everything eye to eye. And I have a great family. We don't fuss, fight among each other. Now, I'm going to say that my brother and I don't. We've watched our sisters fuss and fight among each other. But they do work it out because why? He says we have to have a unity of love that is there. And the girls always work it out. I used to watch my mother and her sisters, and they would... You see them like this at each other, and then the next thing you know, they're hugging and they're all crying and this and that and the other, and then they're laughing again. And we would just say to them, each other, the kids, we look at them and go, it's just them doing their thing again. And so, but they would always come back together because their love was greater than the circumstance situation. That's what Paul is saying, that we need to bear with one another in love, then endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. And so this unity that we have is not your will or my will, but it's the unity of the Spirit of God that is in each and every one of us. And if we are children and believers in Christ, then the Spirit of God is continuously wanting to draw us all together. Because why? It goes on to say that we have one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father who is in all. So we have the Spirit of God, and we're all bound together in Christ Jesus, and we are one. So we're going to walk in the Spirit because there is only one body, one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling. So he is letting us know there's a oneness that ought to be in the body of Christ. And our desire is what? To glorify God as we're continuing to be conformed to his image, that others may come to the saving knowledge of Christ that we ourselves have received. Then Ephesians 4, 7 through 16, it begins to read, but to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Now in this, he ascended. What does it mean but that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descends is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. It's just letting us know that God came to earth, and then he died for man's sins. He was rose from the grave, and then he ascended. Now, the one who ascended was also the one who descended, not only to the earth being born of a virgin, but he descended into the depth in that place of Abraham's bosom. And he said to them, your faith has set you free. I am he in whom you have put your trust in. And the word of God says that he led them who were in captivity, he led them out of that into the freedom that comes into him. So he is the one who ascended, who descended, who then ascended into the heaven far above, that he might fill all things. And Jesus fulfilled everything that was prophesied about him in the fullness of his calling, for this reason that he came, to die for man's sin, be buried, take our death upon him, to raise again with all power and authority, that we might be saved through faith in him and him alone. And then it goes on to say to us, and he himself gave some to be, because he has this authority, he gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Leadership. What is the call upon leadership? It is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry of Jesus Christ. That's what the church is about. We have been called to do the work of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I go to the Father, and because I go to the Father, a greater work you shall do because I go to the Father. You will be impacted with the Holy Spirit. The Comforter will come. He will dwell within you. And when he dwells within you, you will be able to do the work that you have been called to do. I have risen, but you will be able to do a greater work because I am just one. But now the Spirit of God is in each and every one of you. So now you have an area of influence that other people do not have to be able to share this hope with others. So he says that we are there to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for edifying the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So he says to us that there's a place that he desires for us to go in him. Now we're talking about the church, but we're talking about the body of Christ. And it says as believers in Christ that we should come to that place of unity of faith in God through Jesus Christ and of the knowledge of the Son of God, so that we not only have him, but we understand what his call is for our life and what his desire is that we should walk in the fullness of. So it says being saved is not enough. We have to equip one another. We have to teach. We have to encourage. We have to spur one another unto good works. Now you heard that word, spur one another. That means that sometimes we have to say to one another, if you want this, it takes that. If you want this, it takes that. Barbara and I were talking, and we talked about how that we can do so well on our eating plan, and it takes such a long time and a period to make that eating plan work for us. And then we find that that eating plan can go amok in such a little short time, when it took that much time to get the results that we were looking for. But we have to continue on in that. So it's about equipping. And so when we find that we're off of the plan, someone has to say to us, if we desire this, this is what it takes to do. And that's what leadership does. It encourages one another for the work of the kingdom of God, that we might understand. But then it says that we should do this in the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, that we should do it in such a way that we would, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Now I understand that he's not telling us that we're going to be like God, but the striving in our heart is that we should be striving for perfection. If any of you, have any of you watched any of the Olympics that has been on? People were striving for a 10. They didn't always get it. They did not get their personal best, but they were striving for it. Some were striving after. We've seen Olympic records broken. We've seen world records broken. And they were striving for perfection. Now, there was many in there that completed the race. And I want to tell you, the losers in many of those races would outshadow us. They would move past us faster than anything going in the world. They may not have been able to beat the other eight guys that were in front of them, but the rest of the world would be far behind them because they are some of the greatest in the world doing what they're doing. And he says that's how we ought to be in the body of Christ. We may not be the fastest, the greatest in there, but if we're striving after it, we will find that we will have continuously to have personal best. We will be continue to grow, be stronger in him, and we're striving for the greatness that is in Christ Jesus. No Christian ought to settle for being A-okay. God is greater than that. How you doing as a Christian? I'm doing all right. God is greater than all right. We should be striving for the greatness of Christ, the fullness of Christ. We should expect to lay hands on people, see them made whole. We should begin to believe that we pray and begin to see prayers being answered. The children of God, some of us have gone through the motion with no expectation of anything great ever happening. But God is saying here in his word that he has called us to greatness, that we should be striving to be the perfect man, the woman that God has called us to be, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So it says, what are you striving for? Be like Jesus. To be like Jesus. Why would we say to anyone that the only Jesus that people may see on this earth is the Jesus that is in you? Well, I'm just going to tell you, I've seen some Christians, and if that's all the Jesus that they're offering, no wonder nobody's getting saved. But it says that if we're striving after that Jesus, then they ought to begin to see something begin to happen in our life. There ought to be a transformation in us that will allow somebody to see that we have been with Jesus. Now, we heard that. We remember when we were in our last study that it said that Peter and John had been with Jesus. They challenged. They said, you're arresting us because we said to the man, silver and gold have we none, but that we have, we give unto you. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he said, he reached down, grabbed the man by his hand, and the man stood up and he walked and began to praise God, began to shout, all of those things there. He said that, and then they arrested him for that. And they said, what authority do you do that in? And they said, Jesus. And they said, these men have been with Jesus. Shouldn't that be something that somebody would begin to say to us? If this is the mark that they use against us, you've been with Jesus. You've been with Jesus. Why? Because they're seeing something in you that they have not seen in many who go to church. And what Jesus wants us to do is spend time with them. And how do I know that? There was two sisters that were there. Their brother, Jesus had visited their brother and things, and they were busy. Martha was busy. She was getting everything. Hospitality flowed through Martha. She was having everything in place. The food was going to be perfect. The hors d'oeuvres and stuff, everything in place, and the flowers on the table, everything like that. She's just working up a sweat. She wants Jesus to have the best meal and all those things there. And Jesus is talking, and her sister Mary is sitting on the floor eating every word that Jesus is speaking. And she comes to Jesus and she says to him, Jesus, make my sister get up and help me. And he says, oh, Martha, Martha, Martha. You know, you've chosen to be busy about this, and Mary has chosen the greater thing. She has chosen to take my word, to spend time with me, to know me. So wouldn't it be something if somebody accused us of being with Jesus? Yep. The mark against us, you've been with Jesus. Huh? What's different about them? They've been with Jesus. They've been in that word. They've been applying that word to their life and those things there. And when you talk to those Olympians, they said, all of our life, we have put everything aside except we eat this day in, day out. This is what we do. Those gymnasts work at this as a job, as a life source. For what? 5 days that happen every 4 years to become an Olympic champion. And what God is offering us is eternity with him, that we may cast our crowns down at his feet. And we talk about, you don't know how hard it is. You don't know how hard it is. Well, I was watching them flip and jump and things, and I was thinking, if I did that, I would be hurt.
Oh, yeah.
I would hurt. Not because I did the flip, because I didn't do the flip. I would be hurting. But I also know that had someone given me an opportunity, I'm in my 30s and my daughter's doing gymnastics and those things there, and they're saying, Dad, you run and you do this. And I ran and I did this. She said, Dad, but you're cautious. Now you have to do it and you can't be cautious at it. And I ran and I did it. She said, Dad, you're going to get hurt if you don't just do it. But when you're trying to throw your body up in the air and then flip over, that's not right. God did not mean for us to do things such as that. And I had to begin. It took me a while to be able to do that flip she wanted me to do. I'm 30-something. But, you know, she learned it at this small age.
Right.
And then she didn't think about it when she was in her teens, about how to do it. And then when she became a cheerleader in her 20s, a coach, she would say to her students, this is what you do, and she was still doing them. He's calling us to that place, that we would walk as a perfect man, be in the stature and the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of man and the cunning and craftiness of the deceitful plotting. Listen to that. Listen to that. We get this down in our spirit. That we're all to be the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children, immature, not understanding the Word of God, not studying the Word of God, not applying the Word of God. We should no longer be like newborn babes who have just accepted Christ, being tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine. Know your Bible, know your Jesus. So I'm sharing with the family. And I'm sharing with the family. And this person knows Christ now and is their personal Savior. And as I share with this person and about the goodness of God and what God has done in their life, and they told me since when I first started out, though, someone told me about another ministry, and it sounded right, but my life became a mess involved with it because the foundation wasn't Christ Jesus. She said, I spent 7 years as a Jehovah's Witness, and everything went amok. I had been raised in the church, but I didn't know the difference, and I got carried away with another wind and doctrine. And when I tried to apply that that didn't have substance to it to my life became a mess. And I had already so many messes in my life along the way that I thought I was running after the things of God, and I saw a bigger mess and began to make me wonder about my God. She said, but I found my way back to the truth. And all of a sudden, God began to touch my life and change my life once again. And she began to share with me and that how the empowerment of God and what he is able to do in our heart and in our life when we put our trust in him. Because it's very easy to get carried away with every wind and doctrine. As I said, the studies we've been doing have been fantastic. But I don't take everything that Mr. Potter says. Porter says. He's great. He's got a lot of great stuff in there. But I believe that he's also erred in some. And he's given me his denominational teaching and not the Word of God in that. And we have to have the Word of God in us to be able to know the difference. So as we're looking at that, it tells us that there's trickery out there of men and in cunning and craftiness of deceitful plotting. But speaking the truth in love may grow up in all things into him who is the head in Christ Jesus. And so what he is saying is that we're never trying to trick anybody into the things of the Lord. He says, speak the truth of the word of God and let the Holy Spirit do his work in them. I share with people a lot of times, and when I share with them, a lot of times they don't like it. They don't want to hear it. And it's not what they want to hear. And the Bible says, by whatever measure you have placed upon others, you understand that measure will come back at you. And so if it appears that I've thrown some stones, I know that one day some are waiting for me to mess up, and when it happens, they will bury me. The stones will fly. They will let me have it. They will come at me. But it says that we should not be afraid to stand on the word of God, on the word of truth, and begin that others might be set free in that. And so he tells us that in there will be people that will be out there deceiving, but we must speak the truth in love, that they may grow up in all things into him who is the head of the church, who is Christ Jesus, from whom the whole body is joined and knitted together, but whatever joint supplies, every joint supplies, according to the effective work by which every part does its share, causes growth in the body for edifying of itself in love. And so it tells us that everyone has, according to the effective working by every part, so every part, now we have those that of the fivefold ministry, but they're equipping the body to be able to do their part in the kingdom building, in the kingdom working. Because why? All of us are not touching the same people. We're not living in the same neighborhood. We're not always in rubbing against the same person. So we all have a call, and we all have opportunities of influence where we can touch lives that other people may not have an opportunity to get to at that time. And so we're called to do that and to operate and to cause growth in the body for the edifying of itself in love. Now we'll get to the part where they said we left off. The introduction, Ephesians 4, and we're looking at 11 through 13. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors, teachers, to prepare the God's people for a work of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. In the letter of Ephesians, the Apostle Paul describes the kind of leaders God has provided for his church, for it to maintain maturity, Christ-likeness, becoming the spotless bride of Christ, that God is calling us to become Christ's likeness, to mature into Christ's likeness. See, sometimes we forget we are called to be Christ in our community. Christ's likeness. The church has such an awesome call upon its life to live and be like Christ in the community. And if we're like Christ, then we would want people to come to know the Father's love. Yeah. Father showed his love towards us, that while we were yet sinners, he sent his Son to die for us. We should be sharing this hope with other people, and then living that hope in such a way that people would begin to get encouraged by the church. The church should never be a bad thing in a community. And they should not look at us as something that, it's those people. But the community ought to be thankful that God has a church in the community that is praying about circumstances, situations that people are dealing with, that people can go to find sound doctrine, sound teaching for their lives, that they may get instructions on how to live, how to get up every day and make this life work. And it begins with knowing Christ as a personal Savior. So that we would be the spotless bride of Jesus. And in this passage, Paul lists five offices that are referred to as the fivefold ministry: the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastors, and teachers. Many church leaders have taken these verses out of context, elevating these five roles above their rightful place. They emphasize the importance of these offices in local churches, which is is certainly true, but often serve their own interests, need for power and recognition, denying others, what is it, laity? And any kind of involvement in the church government. Others discard the verses altogether, claiming that Paul is speaking in the apostolic age, which has long passed, so that his words are not relevant to us at all anymore. It is therefore the uttermost importance to get a biblical understanding of the fivefold ministry so that our churches will be healthy and functioning according to the will and the plan of God. But while we will focus on these five, we must not forget that Paul is not giving us an exhausted list. In 1 Corinthians 12:28, he is saying, in the church, God has appointed first of all apostles, second prophets, third teachers, and then workers of miracles. Also those having gifts of healing, those able to help others, those with gifts of administration, and those speaking in different kinds of tongues. Only three of the five in Ephesians are repeated here again. While Paul adds other kinds of people and functions, surely we equate an apostle with an administrator. Yet both are in the same list, and there is no reason to assume the hierarchy or that one function has more value than another. Now he says that as a surprise, because man has a tendency to take things out of context. But if you remember, I started the thing off tonight. We have God the Father, God the Word, and God the Holy Spirit. We have the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. We have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They function and they operate and they move in our lives in different ways and stuff, but all fully God. There's only one God, and out of that, not one is higher than the other. And Jesus said, I come to serve the Father, and I'm sending you the Holy Spirit, and he will not make a reputation for himself, but he will speak of those things concerning me. So there's an order in the Godhead, and you don't find God saying, well, I'm bigger than he is. I'm more important than the Father. And Father says, no, I'm higher than all of you. No, God understands. He's breaking himself down so that we can grasp. We can grasp. We really can't grasp God. The understanding of God, we really can't get our hands around it. But he's trying to place it in a way to understand how he desires to function in our lives and how he loves us. So the God-man comes that we might be saved. And to know that salvation is real, God the Holy Spirit has dwelled within inside of us to confirm that this salvation we have is genuine, that it is real and it comes from God. So when he's talking about the fivefold ministries and all of those things, that there should not be one thinking they're higher than the other, God has already explained that there is not one, there is no schism in the body, that we're all equal. On the contrary, those who speak the word of God, who preach and teach, which is all part of the fivefold ministry, are held to higher accountability, and their goal is not to serve themselves, but the flock of God, so that they would attain all of the fullness in Christ. So again, I'm here to equip the body of Christ for the work of the ministry of Jesus Christ. My job is not here to do all of the work. My job is to equip you to do the work that God has called us to do. And then he says there's a difference in there. There's an accountability factor that he places on me that he doesn't place on you. That he says every word that comes out of my mouth, he will hold me accountable to all of the teaching, all of the preaching that I do. That if I give you something that is not him, he will get me for it. He doesn't say he's going to get you for it. He does make it clear. He will get the teacher, the preacher, because he says, I have placed you in this, and you need to understand. There's an accountability factor that I have placed on you, and so you need to be wise before you open up your mouth and begin to instruct people on how they ought to live for me. So I resigned. I'm done. Okay, all right. Yes, sir.
I think
That's right.
And not only that, Mark wasn't an apostle.
No.
And then Luke was a physician.
Yes.
And his story.
Yes.
And he dug into the life of Christ.
Yes.
He was a believer.
Mm-hmm.
And he recorded detail by detail.
Yes.
Especially.
That's right.
Which is in my opinion.
Amen.
So we have Matthew, an apostle.
Yes.
John, an apostle.
Yes.
Luke.
Yes.
None of them.
That's right. That's right.
James, the Testament, as we know it.
Yes, yes.
And then the letter of Christians.
Yes.
All the other.
Yes.
He just moved down excessively.
Yes.
I think that's what Jesus taught us. And he said, move the greater things of God.
Yes.
Jesus is evangelizing God.
Yes.
But it's always that.
That's right.
Still do.
That's right. So he instructed us to go into all the world and preach the gospel that all may come to this saving knowledge that is in Christ Jesus. And so he uses all who will say yes and amen to his will. I found that last week I was sharing with some people that God uses insignificant people for the work of the kingdom. Insignificant people. People who really, when you just look at them, they're really not all that great. But when God touches them, greatness begins to come. When God uses them, things that they could not do in themselves are able to do. Without God, Abram would be a successful businessman. Fatherless, but a successful businessman. And he'll die. And we would never heard a word about him. And then God comes into his life. And we know that Abraham lied twice concerning Sarah. Well, she's not my wife, she's my sister. And so, yeah, she was, but she wasn't. And so you would say it was a white lie. God said he lied. Okay. He was brave. But then he was kind of a coward, too. He had a son named Isaac, and Isaac was not a real good father. He had his favorites, and then Jacob had his favorites, and we find that they weren't perfect people. In fact, there was a lot of dysfunction in the family. And then we have King David, and we don't have time to talk about all of David's dysfunction. If you want to think if your family is bad, read David, the king. And then we find that Jesus sits on the throne of David. Insignificant man is without God. But God takes the insignificant ones and he raises them up for his glory, for his kingdom. And I say that so that we understand he can use any one of us for his glory. There is no such thing as this person was perfect for it. No, none of them was ever perfect for it. And then the first perfect man messed that up. So what we know is that God has to be the one who makes it happen so that none of us are able to boast or be able to talk about that is something in us that is great, that we're able to do this and that we're all of that. So when he's talking about this fivefold ministry, he's talking about the functions, he's talking about the different callings and stuff, it talks about the giftings of God. And with the visibility comes responsibility. And with the responsibility, a higher accountability. Let me go back over that, and let's go back up a little bit farther. We're talking about that end with the fivefold ministry, and he held to higher accountability, and their goals is not to serve themselves, but the flock of God, so that they would obtain all of the fullness of Christ. And with visibility comes responsibility. And with responsibility, the higher accountability, that God has set his leaders in places for his church to function, and those truly called into these places will have been tested and proven, having gone through the fire of preparation, and they display true humility and Christ-likeness, not desiring a position, but wanting to serve their king in any way, and he wants, any way he wants them to. Another office is the deacon. His qualification is set forth in 1 Timothy 3:8-13. The deacon is never called a board in Scripture. Deacon board. It's never called a board in Scripture. They are not to run the church. They are ordained to assist the pastor by ministering to the saints. Acts 6:1-7. The qualifications of a deacon. Likewise, deacons must be reverent, not double-tongued, not giving too much wine, not greedy for money, holding the mysteries of the faith with a pure conscience. But let these also first be tested, then let them serve as deacons, being found blameless. Likewise, their wives must be reverent, not slanderers, temperate, faithful in all things. Let deacons be the husband of one wife, ruling their children and their own things, households well. For those who have served well as deacons obtain for themselves a good standing, a great boldness in faith, which is in Christ Jesus. I'm not going to talk about the call of this. Now, there will be some Baptist churches that are very strong, that there will never be a woman that will pastor their church. They believe that the Bible says exactly this, what it says, that the pastor, just as the deacon, he is the husband of a wife. So that means then it has to be a man, and the woman is called the wife, and so it's not called to be that. It says then for the deacon should be a man, and that in that he has a wife, and she is righteous. But then when we look at Scripture, we find that God in the Old Testament, I can't think of the lady's name, but she was a judge and she had an opportunity. And she says to the other judge, she says, now when you do this here, you can go and do this and you'll win the battle and you'll get all of the honor, because she was giving it to the man and he wouldn't do it. And she did, and she got the honor for it. God uses people for his glory. There's a standard, there's a thing that God gives. But then I would have to say then, if Joyce Myers doesn't have an anointing of God upon her life, then all these other people that are getting saved, coming to know the Lord as their personal Savior by the thousands, that they're really not saved then. Surely God didn't use a woman to lead men to Christ. I cut my teeth listening to Joyce Meyer. Just practical in her teaching.
Well, she couldn't save the baby.
No.
But she could be with the Lord.
That's right. And that's anybody. None of us saves. We plant, we water, he brings the increase. So what I'm saying is that when we see that God can use her, we cannot deny that fact. Then we have Priscilla and Aquila. And then we find that her name was first. And so God was, they're saying that something was more powerful, evident in her, that it was not in her husband. It should have been written that the man's name should have been given first. We have Adam and Eve. There ought to be Abraham and Sarah. There ought to have been the man's name first. But when you read the Scripture, it is her name that is mentioned first in Scripture. When it talks about them, that Paul was ministering with the people with. So I hear this, and yet I cannot deny what I see God doing. And so I'm not going to fight on those things there. I'm going to just trust to see what God has, because it said part of the qualifications is the testing. It means let's not lay hands on anybody too quickly. That we need to see them mature in the things of the Lord. See that they have lived and applied some principles to their life. Let's see if they walk faithfully in those things of God, that you can be to recognize them. And then we know how that is when we look at the book of Acts, and we're going to close here. And it says that, look ye out among you and pick out 7 that are filled with the Holy Spirit, that signs and wonders have been performed in them. pick out seven. I want to say there may have been 150 of them. And they said, we don't need 150 of them to do this job. We only need seven. And we talk about the seven deacons that were appointed at that time. But if they were doing the work of a deacon, they were doing the work. The power of God was on them. They were preaching the word, living the word, doing the things of God. And it says, this is the qualifications of picking men to do what? Pass out some bread. Filled with the Holy Spirit, with wisdom, moving in power, signs and wonders. Why? Because we want them to pass out bread to the Grecian widows. Because why? They were hurting, and he wanted them not only to give them bread, but to be able to minister to their souls. And so he said, I didn't need bread passed around. I need anointed people to do the work of the ministry. And so God is calling us to be anointed to carry out the trash tonight. Now don't say, Pastor, that's your job. Because Norma would do that. And so I just say it to you is that God is calling us and wanting to use us and use every one of us for his glory. Let's pray. Any questions before we pray? Father, we come before you, Lord, and we do thank you, Lord, for this time. We thank you for your word. And Lord, and we thank you, dear Heavenly Father, that you have laid down a parameter, Lord, on how that we ought to look, Lord, and begin to look at those in leadership, Lord, and see, Lord, that you have called people into a place, Lord, to do the work of. Lord, I pray tonight, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that we will not just choose, Lord, because they have a heartbeat, that they'll fill this spot, Lord, and we just need somebody to vote on. But Lord, we'll be looking for them who have been tested and proven through you. That their faith, Lord, is in you. The word of God lives and operates within them. They study to show themselves approved, the word of the deeds, not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth that you have given. So Lord, we come tonight. We're asking you, Lord, to equip us, prepare us, Lord, that we may be that church you are coming back, Lord, moving in the fullness of Christ's life and living before all with the empowerment of Christ operating in our life. We want to lift up Linda Hackett's son to you tonight, Lord Rob. But again, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, they said that the liver has failed. But Lord, I said to him and I said to his mother, do not be afraid, just believe. Lord, we know that you are greater than these things that come into our lives. You're greater than our past. You're greater than our struggles. Let us begin to look to you, Lord, and expect to be healed, that we might move forward in the calling that you have placed upon our lives. Lord, I want to lift up Naomi to you tonight, Lord, that you would just, Lord, touch those ears, Lord, and then, Lord, this shingles thing, Lord, right now, Lord. Lord, take away the pain. Take away the pain, Lord, right now. Dry up the blisters, Lord, all of those things, Lord. Whatever ringing, Lord, may be going on in her ear, in her eye, all of those things, Lord, in her face, Lord, we say stop in the name of Jesus, and we declare your healing. In Jesus' name we pray. Lord, I thank you tonight, Lord, for all that you're doing. We thank you, Lord, for the report, Lord, that we have heard, that of Joyce Nevergall, cancer free. And so, Lord, nothing is too hard for you. I pray tonight, Lord, and when we look at our circumstances and situation, let us hold on to your word of truth. Let us believe, dear Heavenly Father, what you could do for the living girl, you were also able to do for the girl who now, they said, is dead. You said, don't be afraid, just believe. So, Lord, whatever we may be facing in our life, you're saying to us, your perfect love casts out all fears. And so, Lord, may we look to you with an expectation of victory for our lives. In Jesus' name we pray.